just underlining or encircle the word live. But you find the one, how many times? Live. In chapter 4, verse 1, you'll be able to see this one. As prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy. Okay, that's the first one. And then you go to verse 17. It says, so I tell you this and insist in the Lord that you must no longer live as the Gentile. And then you are going to go to chapter 5. Verse 1, verse 2, he said that live a life of love. So, in verse 15, he said, be careful then how you live, and why. So, this should not make your attention that these words are repeated by Apostle Paul emphasizing how we as Christians should live. But before we go, let's have our Bibles again. Let's have our Bibles again. Amen. This is my Bible.
This is God's Word.
I am what it says I am.
I am
a child of God.
I have
been born into His kingdom.
Forgiven by His grace.
And that's my victory. I have what it says I have. I have eternal life. I have a place in heaven. I have peace and joy. I boldly confess that my mind is alert. My heart is receptive to receive God's instruction, God's inspiration, God's rebuke for me today. I also boldly confess that Jesus is Lord. And He is coming again. Amen. So that's a bold confession that we are making. Amen. Praise God. Okay. President Barack Obama has a resolution for the new year. Do you have one? Or you got tired of making one? He has a resolution for the new year, and with the Republican Congress convening next week, and that will be on Tuesday. And his New Year's resolution is this, according to the news, to operate more and use executive action less. That's according to Newsmax. Are you, the other picture is President Obama, and the other picture is McConnell, okay. Now, from his vacation in Hawaii, our president was already making some campaign. He studied in Hawaii, and then he's going to pass on to, I think, 3 or 4 states before he's going to be back in Washington, D.C. And his campaign is that he's campaigning for education. You know, that it will be easier for people to be educated, and then that more people will be able to afford buying house. However, I think one thing that he is forgetting is that our biggest problem, an overview of the United States national debt, the current outstanding public debt of the United States is already $18,463,862,247,389.05. And that is July 2nd.
January.
Oh, January 2nd. Sorry. So it was past 2 days. estimated population of the United States, that including you and me, is 319,727,763. Of course, the counting is not including the illegal. Oh, sorry, use the word illegal, undocumented. The national debt has continued to increase an average of $2.49 billion per day since September 30, 2012. According to Washington, Associated Press, the first Republican-dominated Congress to confront President Obama, the GOP leaders will focus on bolstering the economy and cutting the budget. I think the President Obama is more on spending rather than cutting, so Republicans are cutting the budget. So when the new Congress raises the curtain Tuesday, Republicans will learn both the House and the Senate for the first time in 8 years. According to the news, GOP leaders want to showcase their legislative priorities, mixing accomplishments with showdowns with President Obama, sharing government shutdowns and other chaotic standoffs. So you will notice that one. And according to the news that we have read, is that President Obama is ready to use his pen. U.S. Census Bureau, U.L.A. Times, according to the census state-to-state migration statistics, almost 250,000 more workers left California between 2007 to 2013. And of course, those who left, nearly all of them, are making less than $50,000 a year. It is because housing here in California is very expensive, and so people are migrating away from California. Probably you have remembered that those ones who are retiring, most retirees are getting out of California as well. Companies also are getting away from California because it is too expensive. And many of them are already in Texas, in Colorado, and in other states. I don't know if Yahoo will move out. Now you see this migration from California to top destinations. Number one is a low line, is Texas. Number two, Arizona. Number three is almost the same as Arizona is Nevada. And then state of Washington, and then Oregon, then Florida, then Colorado, then New York. Have you seen the one in the newspaper that the campaign of New York is that once you are going to put up a business over there for 10 years as a company, you are not going to pay a tax.
Wow.
So many are moving to New York. Then Illinois, and then Virginia. Now AirAsia flight QZ8501, so far out of the more than 160 passengers, including crews, only 30 bodies found and recovered. Plane still missing, but they say that there are two large objects found in air of the wreckage, and they are sure that those what they have found in the deep of the ocean is part of that missing plane. He said that the black box is still missing. Division officials of Saturday that they were confident of the wreckage they have found. And they have located with the use of the instrument they have. You see those on the bags are bodies of passengers. Obamacare. And the other known as Affordable Care Act is also taking effect, 2015. Enrollment, by the way, is already over. So it's taking effect. Those who will qualify for the government subsidy will be happy. But according to Reverend Al Sharpton, who owes $4.5 million in back taxes, and the IRS is not doing something about it. Yet they are going to run for those ones who owes $25. You know what he said? My race, the men are not financially capable to live without government subsidy. So more will be on government support and lesser people employed full-time, meaning can't afford to pay healthcare costs. According to the news, it will be trillion for the next few years. It will be more than $1 trillion added to the deficit. Good news or bad news? We don't know what lies ahead. Unauthorized immigrants line up for California driver's licenses as of 3 p.m. local time. That is, I think, the other day, Friday. Some 11,000 people have applied for licenses under the law statewide. That's in California. And it also says California on Friday will start taking driver's license application from the nation's largest population of immigrants in the country illegally. I'm just quoting it from the news. California is one of the 10 states that now provide licenses to immigrants in the country illegally. The licenses issued to immigrants without legal status will include distinctive marking and are not considered a valid form of federal identification. Right? If they are allowed to drive, they said that the federal identification or leave limitation is that they cannot use that license when they are going to board a plane. And I said, what is the difference? They are allowed to drive. So starting on Friday, immigrants who pass their initial hurdles will get a driving permit, but they must return for a driving test before they can get the new licenses, which will be marked with the words, federal limits apply. What lies ahead of us for this year 2015 can be described by the title in the first day of the New Year's, our daily bread issue. We are bread of one. Better or worse? By David McCaslin. He said, people everywhere are hoping that this year will be better than the last. But no one knows what will happen. But will this year be better for you and me? According to David McCaslin, he said it is both. It is yes or no. I agree with him. Politically, our world will not become better. Do you agree with that? What's happening in the Middle East? What is happening in Europe? What is happening in Africa? Are you aware that the IS also is making their ground in Lebanon? They're making the ground even in near Tripoli. And even you have heard, I just said, the news this morning is that there was a blast, you know, in Somalia. It's in a country, you see, in Africa. Have you heard about our news in the Philippines? Between the Bangsa Moro and the MILF? They are trying to raid each other. Now the Bible is clear, you know, terrible times will come. Wickedness will increase, according to Apostle Paul in the book of Timothy. Now spiritually, Jesus said, the love of many will wax cold. Now it's a simple understanding. It is because, as you know, when we are studying about the Ten Commandments, you will notice that the Ten Commandments of the Father, did you notice that one? The Ten Commandments is number 5 on the Father. Father and mother, honor your father and mother. Why it is very critical? It is because when the children can no longer honor their mother, they don't know what to honor, whom to honor. If they're not going to recognize their parents, how much more for God? That's why it will not be a surprise when the man, you know, there's a video, you know, the big man in Ferguson, you know, that grabs hold of those people, owner of the store, and will grab hold, you know, the collar of the police. There's a new video that came out of the in Facebook. In their apartment, he just called, and then the old man, you know, he's very yanky, you know, and he just bucks him in the face. However, as the world gets more chaotic and the moral and spiritual atmosphere gets darker, the dawn of Christ's return and the message of the blessed hope will become bright.
Amen. Amen.
That's the one that is positive in the midst of negative. There are two signs of the New Year's entrance. One of sadness, like the losing of loved ones by the crash of Air Asia. The ISIS, you know, killing. I think they have, the ISIS have already killed, 100 Syrians. And the ISIS are already beheading and killing those foreigners who have joined them because they have already suspected that they are infiltrators. The second is one of gladness. So the one is sadness, the other one is gladness. It will be gladness for the undocumented immigrants lining up in the embassy in our country, probably to them. You know, it is a long awaited time. I think even Republicans are happy too. They will control the House and the Senate starting Tuesday. But President Obama is not happy, he is sad. And he's threatening to use his pen. I think they said that one of the three major issues that the Senate and Congress will tackle is the Keystone pipeline. President Obama is ready to veto it. Now, with those images and scenarios in the atmosphere before us for the 2015, how should we Christian believers look at the future and live getting ahead? Shall we be bogged down with these negatives? Shall we be troubled summits? And instead of moving forward, we'll be lagging behind. Where do we begin? The answer could be derived from many passages in the scriptures. In spite of our struggles and seemingly bad experiences in the past, we are commanded to live and move on in our lives. Don't retreat. Because history should be moving forward. And I like when somebody said that history is actually his story, not ours. When Adam and Eve fell into sin, the Lord cursed the ground, banished them from the Garden of Eden, and allowed them to live with the cherubim guarding so they will not be able to eat the tree of life. I was reading Genesis chapter 5. Will you please open it with me in Genesis chapter 5? It is because it is interesting, Genesis chapter 5. And I'm going to point out these things that I'm trying to point out here. Now in Genesis 5, you will notice that it is about from Adam to Noah. It's the account of Adam's life. He said that when this person had lived on the number of years, he became the father of a son, and then he became the father of a son, and so lived number of years. Let me repeat it 10 times. Probably it is because he's counting about 10 generations, you know, from time of Adam, from Adam to Noah. But you notice the one? In verse 3, when Adam lived 130 years, he had a son in his own likeness, in his own image, and he named him Seth. And after Seth was born, Adam lived 800 years. Notice the one, he's repeated in their lips. Living life, it should be moving forward. It's repeated 10 times. But I notice over here that or I thought I was right in my conclusion that the life of these people over here are decreasing. But I was wrong. It is because it was not decreasing, because at the time when I reached, at the time of Methuselah, he was the oldest. How many years? 900? Methuselah in 25, 969. But Jared lived 962. That's in verse 20. They have long lives, isn't it? So it's also live. I'm just trying to emphasize here, it's about living. The wickedness of man increased, and that has grieved God. He brought flood upon mankind and all living animals, and they all died. But he caused no one, his family, to live. Move ahead and start life all over again. I think it is a great encouragement to us that at times when we are going to fail and at times when we are going to stumble, we are encouraged to start life all over again and move ahead. Great, so please move on. Okay, it's there. Okay. As I read through the scriptures and brush through the books, I have one conclusion. The scriptures was given by God to men how we can live our lives on this earth and prepare for eternity. You see, amen with that?
Amen.
That's why the Sunday school kid, he said the Bible stands for basic instruction before leaving earth. The Bible was given in such a way that we know how to live our life while we are here on this earth in preparation for eternity, because the Lord Jesus Christ saved us and God is preparing a place for us in heaven. And the question again is, where do we begin to live our life? Saan tayo magsisimula? Well, sometimes if you don't know where you are, you don't know where you are going. So we should know where to begin. We should know where we are. And I believe that as believers, I have one conclusion where we are. We are in God's hands.
Amen.
Amen? Amen. Regardless of the chaos that is happening around, regardless of the economic troubles, there's one thing I know for sure, is that our lives is in the hand of God who knows the future. So the answer for that, and where do we begin? So as the year 2014 passes, we begin counting on the first day of the first month of the year. But where to begin our life as we live on this new year? Now I'm going to suggest this one thing. Number one, I would suggest that we will begin with God. Let's not begin with what we have earned. Let's not begin with what we have accumulated in the bank. Let's not begin with what we have lost. Let's just begin our lives even for this year, and let's begin with God.
Amen.
I believe that when we are going to begin our lives with God, we are always a winner.
Amen.
Would you say amen?
Amen.
The first sentence in the first book of the Bible is called Genesis. He said, in the beginning, God. I remember reading the book, The Purpose-Driven Life, by Rick Warren. He said that we are going to begin with God. The point of reference of our life is God. In the beginning of many chapters and so many paragraphs from Genesis to Job begins with the Lord making an action for man. Then the Lord, you see the term, then the Lord, common expression when you are going to read or browse through in this book. Take, for example, the book of Deuteronomy. If you will open the book of Deuteronomy with me, it is exciting. It is because I will point some in the book of Deuteronomy. If you will begin even in chapter 1, you will be able to find, it said, the Lord your God, the Lord your God, the Lord our God. So you will be able to find for almost every beginning of the chapter of the book of Deuteronomy, and even the paragraphs, you will be able to find, it said, the mention of the Lord God. It's the Lord God who is making an action. I'm sure that I have preached on this in the book of Deuteronomy, that the book of Deuteronomy is actually a book that was given to the people of Israel, how they are going to live their lives when they will be in the land of promise, that's in the land of King. It is not by coincidence also that the book of John begins with this verse, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The book enumerated and narrated proofs and events and incidents that Jesus is the Son of God. That's why the book of John is actually emphasizing on the divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the book ended with saying Jesus did many other things as well as that if they were written, the world cannot contain. But who Jesus is, he's God. The book of Revelation also begins with God and it ends with God. The resonating message from God's word for us today as we begin our life for this year 2015, begin it with God.
Amen.
Begin your day with God and end your day with God. Begin your week with God and end it with God. Begin your new year with God and end it with God. You're not even supposed to begin your day and your year with a quarrel with your spouse. Some of us might be able to carry some debts from 2014 because we paid them by installments. But let's begin our life with God. You'll never make mistakes. You will never be down. When you are going to begin, when we are going to begin our lives with God. Did you say amen?
Amen.
That's how I like the song. For I know who holds tomorrow. Bring your day with God in prayer and end your day with a praise to God. Begin your week with a prayer to God and end it with praises to God. Begin your new year with a prayer to God and end it with a praise to God. Because I'm going to guarantee you that some of us, and many times it happens to us, that when we are going to pray and then we forget them. Because sometimes it's dependent upon the situation, even though we pray. Like for example, Sister Mila, and I think she has a very, I mentioned that one last, and she is here, and she prayed that, she said that events, important events in her life like Christmas, Thanksgiving, her birthday and the new year.
Wedding anniversary.
That's a many important events. Thanksgiving, birthday, Christmas, New Year, anniversary, almost five events. And at a time when I think Brother Dennis would like to go home, he is willing to pay whatever the cost. And I think that Sister Mila was not happy about it. You know, but do you notice that even how God works? Sometimes when we have prayed, you know, as if we are not so serious about it, but you know, God is serious for even every not serious prayer we offer. That's why even in Tagalog, you know, he said, "Huwag kang magbiro sa Diyos." Don't make a joke with God in your prayer. Because God is not making a joke. Even though at times, you know, God has a sense of humor, but he's not making a joke. I like Psalms because it begins with a plan on living blessed and ending with a jubilant expression of praise unto the Lord. Did you see that one? Try to see in the book of Psalm 1. He said, "Blessed is the man who walk not in the counsel of the ungodly, but his delight is in the law of the Lord." And then the ending of that, he said, "For the Lord watches the way of the righteous." Did you notice that one? And then in Psalm 150, how many times, how many of the word praise is mentioned in Psalm 150? See the answer over there? Many times. How many times mentioned? 10 or 12?
13.
I think in the NIV it's about 12.
I think it's 12.
Yep. Okay. So if you decide to live a life of blessing and get ahead this year, begin it with God. That is what the message from the book of the greatest king who ever lived, King David, and he said, "Blessed is the man who delights in the law of the Lord, for the Lord watches over his way." Of the way of the righteous in the NIV. So there, Psalm 150, the word praise is 12 times. The wisest king who ever lived, King Solomon. You know, this is what he said. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge and wisdom. If you would like to become wise, you cannot become wise in your own insights and in your own understanding. You can become wise by beginning with God. To begin our life with God, there are three actions we must do. Okay, when we agree to begin our life with God, three actions we are willing to do. One, align with God's plan. Hindi mo pwede siyang salungatin. You cannot go against the plan of God. You cannot even say, Lord, I would like to have my own way. I think doing our own way, God knew already that when we are going to do our own way, we will always fail. And we are not going to resolve into what He has intended our life to be. In the scripture, you will be able to find that this word and this truth that I am saying, that if you wanted to live and to be blessed by God, starting with God is one way, and this truth is resonating all over to the scripture, is aligned with God's plan. Could you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God's plan for us, even from the beginning, is to enjoy Him and be blessed with the work of His hand. God's plan for Adam and Eve was that they savored the goodness of His work in the garden. Instead, they left and hide because of shame. Why? Because they did not align with God's plan. They followed Satan's plan. That's why Satan said, you know, did really say this? Did he say that you really die? I said, no, you will not die. But God said, you will. God's plan was to multiply, not to murder each other. You notice that Cain murdered his own brother. So the scriptures were given to us so we can be aligned, or we can be aligned to His plan. God has a wonderful plan for our lives, the way we live. By aligning with God's plan, we can get ahead and live blessed. Could you say amen?
Amen.
This truth is very clear in Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of mockers or scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law that he meditate day and night, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth in its season. His leaf shall not wither, whatsoever he does. It is very encouraging that whatever God says to us, it will prosper. It will accomplish. It will happen. We want to prosper, is it not? If we do, the only way is to align with God, to align with the one who blesses. And that one is the Lord. The Lord watches the way of the righteous. This could be paraphrased by saying the Lord watches over the way of the one who is in line and in agreement with His plan. It will be very hard when you agree to this, Lord, I'm going to do my own way. Lord, please bless this plan that I have. Remember, God is in the business of like a contractor. Okay, I'll make my plan, and then, okay, then the project begins. When the captivity of Israel to Babylon was about to finish, Prophet Jeremiah declared the Lord's purpose for them. In verse 11 of chapter 29, he said, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plan to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Most of the time, we are in chaos in our lives. It is because we run our own lives in our own plan. And it is because the plan, sometimes, you know, we cannot wait upon the Lord. We go ahead. Number two, if you want to begin with God, number one, align with God, and then number two is adapt to God's purpose. God has a purpose in blessing us, that He had a purpose in creating man. Could you say amen?
Amen.
That's why God has a purpose in creating man and a woman. Not a man and a man. Okay, or a woman and a woman. God has a purpose in creating a woman out of the rib of a man. God has a purpose of the Israelite wandering in the desert of sin. God has a purpose in bringing them out of Egypt and giving them the land of Canaan. Living our lives outside of God's purpose makes our existence meaningless and miserable. That is what King Solomon said. Meaningless, everything is meaningless. He said he has projects accomplished, indulged in pleasure, whatever his eyes could see and his mind could think. He involved himself to as many women as he thinks. And then in the end, he said, meaningless without adopting God's purpose. Their meaning is only realized, the meaning of things, projects, pleasures, marriage, if God is in there. That is why he said, in chapter 12, he said, remember your Creator in the days of your youth. Why in youth? Because at our youthful life, it is the time we are going to seek the meaning of life. They call it the crisis, identity crisis. When you are 14 to 15, you don't know where you belong. Are you a man? A young woman? Or a kid. Connecting it to what Apostle Paul have said in Ephesians about our salvation from sin, our life's purpose is that we will be to the praise of His glory, and that we will be an edifice and a finished product demonstrating His tremendous power through Christ. Three, ask God to prosper. Now here's this. I think it's a simple mathematics and a simple reasoning is this. When you have aligned yourself to God, okay? And the second one is when you have adopted God's purpose. What do you think? Is it hard for us to be blessed by God? Is it hard for us that when we are going to pray, God will not answer our prayers? I think it's the opposite. He is ready to answer the prayers of God's children. He is ready to answer the prayers of those who are aligned to Him and adopting His purpose. That's why the third is that ask God to prosper you. If we are going to do our job, if we are going to allow Him to work in our life, it is His duty to prosper us. When men had fallen into sin, men had come to a notion that getting what we wanted, like happiness and prosperity. We think of prosperity as accumulating as many possessions we don't need. We came into a notion that greed is gratification rather than dissatisfaction. And so we live in disillusionment and discontentment. After we have all this, we are still not satisfied. We are still troubled. Just think for a moment. And we are going to think of, we think it's so comfortable to have a big house. When you're going to have a big house, especially if it is cold time, you have a bigger electricity bill. When you have an expensive house, your taxes is big also. And if your salary is not growing, then you are in trouble. There are many friends that we have seen. They bought a bigger house, a bigger house. You know what happened? The less sleep they had. Because they keep on working. That's why they keep on asking, do you have overtime there, Mom? Can I have more overtime? The trouble that we had. I remember one of our members, you know, in the Philippines, when the from beef homes, they move into that village called Ayala, Alabama. You know, and at the time, you know, it is a place that many are seeking. And our member said, how I wish that we can still go back into the house where we were. Because at the time when we are in that big house, we contact our children with the telephone, you know, the phone. We could hardly see each other. It is important, therefore, to ask God for His blessings and for Him to prosper us. Now, that's why I put the word prosperity, quote unquote. How do you view prosperity? Are we going to view prosperity in the light of the world? Or are we going to view prosperity in the light of God's purpose for our lives? A young man who had become successful, a stockbroker, has said to his mom, he said, Mama, why are you so happy when you are always running out of money? And you don't have a portfolio even to stand on. And her answer is that, son, I am happy because God has been blessing me every day. That's why I'm happy. Sometimes the more money we have to protect, the more troubles we have. Sometimes when we are so troubled, we blame others, even our own relatives, stealing our money. Kinuha mo yung pera ko eh. A nice and interesting short story in the Old Testament is the life of Jabez. Are you familiar with that?
Yes.
Okay, the life of Jabez in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 9 and 10. It's very short, the story of this man. Only two verses. He was born in pain by his mother, so he was named Jabez. And the meaning of the word Jabez, in Hebrew meaning might be, his name is pain. Now it is interesting that in the Bible, you are going to live according to your name. That's why when I look at my name, Abednego, it looks like I'm not surprised if I have went through all those struggles. Because when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, one of the three friends of Daniel, their lives were hard. They were thrown into the fiery furnace. So Jabez, he said he knew that according to his name, he is going to live according to his name, and he is going to live in pain. And so he prayed unto the God of Israel, and this is his prayer. And Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. And his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bear him with sorrow. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed, and enlarge my house, and that thine hand might be with me, and that thou wouldest keep me from evil, and that it may not grieve me. Now I underline the ones that I said. And God granted him what he requested.
Amen.
As I was thinking about the prayer of Jabez, I like that one because he aligned himself with God. He adapted his plan so that in his life God will be glorified. What was your prayer for God for this year? Well, I have no doubt in my heart that when we align to God's plan, adapt to God's purpose, and ask God to prosper us, prosper you, the God of heaven and earth will grant your rewards.
Amen.
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 Don't begin with your name. Don't begin with your pain. Nor you are going to say, Lord, masakit kasi ako, ihil mo ako, Lord. Kung ihil mo lang ako, Lord, gagawin ko ito. That's baliktad. No, don't make a condition that, you know, you are going to serve Him, you are going to praise Him, you are going to begin with your healing. No, begin with Him. Align with Him. Praise Him. Worship Him. It might be that in your pain you don't understand what has happened, but I would like to tell you, you will not be able to understand. But sometimes God allows it to happen in your life because He knew the purpose, so that you will be able to recognize that it is only God who is powerful, who knows the future. Be able to control the uncontrollable things in our life.
Amen.
He wants you to recognize that He is God. Let's begin recognizing our God. That Jesus is, how do we recognize Jesus? That Jesus is our Savior. That Jesus is Lord. I think those two things are important. Not only that He saved us from sin, but it is also that He is Lord of every circumstance, of everything in our lives. Would you say amen?
Amen.
Isn't it wonderful? I think it's really wonderful. It's happy to think of that. That the Lord Jesus Christ is not only my Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ is my Lord as well. He lords over the blessings that I have. He lords over the trouble and chaos that will come even for this year. He is in control. Would you say amen?
Amen.
So when trouble will come, be comforted. I like that one. When the apostle who said in the book of Romans chapter 8. You know that one, right? What is it in Romans chapter 8? When troubles will come and you don't understand. But the promise is that all things work together for good. You have to remember. If you remember what the prayer in the plan of God in Jeremiah chapter 20 verse 19, for I know the plans I have for you. It's not to hurt you. Jeremiah, it's not to hurt you. It is to prosper you. It is to bless you. So when you understand and you know that with God, you know how comforting it is. How liberating it is. And that it means to be prospered and to be blessed by God. Amen.
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 Let's begin with God. Don't begin with what you don't have. Let's begin with God. Father in heaven, how encouraging it is to be reminded. With the circumstances around